He said, "I want you to know, if it were Elvis Presley arriving, I wouldn't have taken the time to meet him. I couldn't have had a warmer or more sincere greeting to Las Vegas than from Mr. Jerry Gordon, the vice president and general manager of Caesar's Palace. Driving his limousine along the Las Vegas Strip, I had a glimpse of the unique city which had invited me to come and minister. The luxurious hotels whose plush casinos and lavish showrooms attract 9 million visitors a year, spending billions of dollars on round-the-clock entertainment. In an atmosphere so totally devoted to pleasure and amusement, was it sheer presumption to think there might also be a spiritual appetite? What sort of response could one expect here to the message that the God of miracles wants to satisfy the deepest longings of every human heart? Many would say that I, too, was gambling. That the odds were against me as I staked to my conviction that the craving of the soul for satisfaction is in reality a spiritual hunger. Then within me, I felt an overwhelming surge of confidence. Yes. The world's most glittering resort city would indeed respond.
Thank you.
I became a new creature in Christ Jesus. I have a great high priest at the very throne of God. In the person of Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son. And everything that you and I receive today must come through Jesus. Adore him, softly begin to choir, hallelujah. Great oratorio, adore him and worship him. Alleluia. John in the book of Revelation said, and I heard the voices of the redeemed of all ages as they worshiped him. He's the only one who can give peace of mind and peace of soul. The great high priest, the very Son of the living God. Bow with our very life to be so careful to give you all the praise and all the honor and all the glory for everything that the Holy Spirit does in this place of worship today. That's one thing you'll not share with any human being. You'll not share the glory. You'll not share the praise. And before the visible and the invisible, we vow to give you the glory for the marvelous manifestation, the supernatural manifestation of our God. Not one person, I pray, shall leave this place of worship this Saturday afternoon. The same person they were when they entered. It's a simple prayer, but grant it, I pray, for Jesus. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Oh, thank you. They're here from everywhere.
They tell me that I don't know how many are on the outside still trying to get in. They should have made Convention Center a little larger when they built it here in Las Vegas, you know. There was one of the very first things that the press asked. Understand, I think it was about 2 weeks ago, and I do not mind telling you that it came from, and you're probably here, from Time Magazine. One of the reporters from New York City called, and you're probably here. We got everything under the sun here today. And so, they said, the very first question, they said, we understand you're going to Las Vegas. And I said, yes. And they said, so you're going to Las Vegas to convert the Sin City, you know? I said, no, I've just returned from New York. The sin in New York City is just the same as in Las Vegas. It's no greater in Las Vegas than New York City. And I said, and it's no greater in Las Vegas than it is in Los Angeles. You see, it just seemed to be publicized more here in Las Vegas. It's just like, no, I haven't come to convert Las Vegas. Know that. We'll have the same kind of service here today that we have in St. Louis, Providence, Rhode Island, Ottawa, Canada, in Sweden, in London. Because remember, all cities are made up of human beings, of humanity. And human nature is the same everywhere. And it's just like that. And remember something. I'm here today because of the wonderful mayor of Las Vegas. And you may not realize it, but we are making history today in Las Vegas. Literally. Understand that this is the first time in the history of Las Vegas that the mayor and the city council voted to make it a certain day. And you know, I wouldn't be here without Jimmy, our own Jimmy McDonald, who's been with us for years, who has thrilled literally thousands with the singing of the gospel. And here he is, Jimmy McDonald. Come on, Jimmy. Come on, Jimmy.
Fairest of 10,000 is Jesus Christ, my Savior, the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He is all my glory, and in this heart of mine, forevermore I'm singing a song of love divine. not sing it, this song of joy and freedom? For mortals only know it, the ransomed and the free. Slaves were they in bondage and deepest misery, but now they sing triumphant their song of liberty. Just know he watches me. Now I sing because I'm so happy, and I sing because I know he
Jimmy, come on, I've got to tell it. Maybe for the last time, everybody has heard me tell it. But it's the first time I've been in Vegas. I'll never forget it. We were someplace, see, Jimmy has been with me for years. And we were someplace, Eureka, wasn't
Eureka.
It? In the Civic Auditorium there, one of the nightclub owners had requested that we come. He'd been converted, and by the way, he's here someplace in the auditorium. That's right. You know, this is the most unorthodox ministry in the whole world.
Amen.
Yeah, what do you mean, amen? You don't have to agree so hard with it. But it is. Now, where in the world would you find anything as unorthodox as this ministry? It's just like that. You see, we don't care whether you're a Protestant, a Catholic, whether you're a Jew or a Gentile. It doesn't make any difference to God, so why should it make any difference to us? I mean, it's just like that. That's right. I consider myself a Protestant, but I want to thank the Catholic Father. And this is one of the most beautiful things that has happened since my arrival. There's a Catholic priest someplace here in this auditorium today who had a public mass for me yesterday in the large Catholic church here in Las Vegas. I think that's marvelous. You know? It's just like that. I wouldn't be at all surprised before I get out of Vegas, I'll be invited to the synagogue. And you want to know something? I'll go. I mean, it's just like that. Don't interrupt me, Jimmy. I want to say something. Well, we were in Eureka, and it was after the service when the cutest little boy, he kept following Jimmy. Every place Jimmy went, he was right behind him. Finally, the crowd was gone. We dismissed the service. And finally, Jimmy turned around and he said to the youngster, "Honey, can I do something for you?" The kid said, "Mm-hmm." He said, "I'm going to ask a question." Jimmy said, "All right, what is it?" "Well," he said, "Mr. Jimmy, tell me, are you related to Catherine Kuhlman?" Well, you know, I thought it was the funniest thing I'd ever heard. I laughed when Jimmy told me that. But it wasn't until about 2 weeks afterwards. And I said, "Hey, Jim, you know, you told me about the little boy. You told me the question he asked you. But I said, you know, I just now wonder, what did you say to him? What was your answer?"
"My answer was yes." And you see, the thing that had him confused was the fact that she has red hair and I don't.
I may understand, say, mm-hmm. I feel sorry for the rest of you. Well, say, while Jimmy was singing, I looked down, and my word, I see down here on the front row some of the most distinguished men in the medical profession. What are you doing here? I see a very marvelous, distinguished lady in the medical profession. I think that's marvelous. I'm glad you're sitting on the front seat so you won't miss anything. I see down there a man who's on the staff of Johns Hopkins Hospital. I see a couple of you medical men down there. I know you. I see a couple of you who first came to the services as skeptics. Dr. Kastorf, you were one of the greatest skeptics I have ever had. There were times I could have killed you. And I think, Dr. Fryman, you came as great a skeptic because of your training in England, and you had not been trained, you know, to believe these miracles. But had you ever thought, really, that all healing is of God? Really, when it comes right down to it. You great surgeons can perform surgery, but remember something, the greatest surgeon in the world has to wait until after he performs his surgery. He has to wait for a supernatural power to do the healing. And it's just like that, you know. I'm going to speak to you for a very short time, not more than 10 minutes. But I'm going to talk to you about something that's vitally important. This is not a sermon. I'm just talking to you because I feel that I owe it to you. I don't care where you go these days, everybody's talking about the uncertainty of the future. And I feel that I owe it to you to talk about what the Bible says regarding the future. There's an uncertainty in the very atmosphere. Everybody knows it. Everybody is discussing it. What's happening? I had come to Las Vegas 6 months ago. If I had come to Las Vegas 5 years ago and would have told you that the hour would come when the United States of America would have a president and a vice president who was not elected by the people, you would have called me a fake. You would call me a fanatic. And yet, do you realize that we as a nation, the greatest nation, and don't minimize the United States of America, this very hour I stand before you. First of all, I'm proud that I belong to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, that I am a Christian, that God is my Heavenly Father. And secondly, I am proud that I am an American. I want you to know that. I'm proud I am an American. Watch something. There isn't a strong personality on the scene. Nations are crumbling. I don't have to prove it. You know it as you watch your telecasts. You know it as you read your newspapers. Nations are crumbling so quickly. Something is happening. That's the reason the very atmosphere is filled with uncertainty. What's happening? What's happening? That's the reason I'm taking this time today, this Saturday afternoon, to just tell you what the Word of God says. There's no great ruler, no great power on the scene today. Men today are literally like men on a chessboard. Nations literally are as men on a chessboard, and world affairs are shaping up exactly like God's Word said they would. God's Word is infallible. Know that. I don't care what your preconceived idea may have been regarding the Bible. It's more up to date than tomorrow morning's newspaper. God made a promise to Abraham. God made a covenant to Abraham and Abraham's seed. And when God makes a promise, when God gives a covenant, He'll keep it. I don't care whether it's to a nation or to an individual, and you can stake your very life on it. And God made certain promises and covenants to Abraham and the seed of Abraham. For 39 centuries, the seed of Abraham has been a scattered people, hated, a people of the country, murdered, spat upon. Around the world, they've been scattered to the east, to the west, to the north, to the south. Name it. Unwanted. Without a homeland. And yet God made a covenant with the seed of Abraham. 39 centuries have come and 39 centuries have gone. And it seemed like the most unlikely thing in the world that there'd ever be a nation Israel. And that the seed of Israel, the seed of Abraham, would be gathered together again. And I want to go on record this Saturday afternoon in Las Vegas, giving you the word of God, and you can stake your very life on it. Regardless of how it looks in the Middle East, and remember, war is inevitable. Sometimes I think we like to be like the ostrich. We like to bury our faces in the sand and we won't face reality. And we say with optimism, tomorrow it's going to be better. Tomorrow it's going to be better. And I'm the greatest optimist in the world. But when it comes to the Word of God, we have to face facts. Remember, we've got to face facts. War is inevitable. There will be war in the Middle East, but I want you to know something. The Bible says this absolute authority, that which is infallible, the Bible says, for God gave it to Moses in that burning bush. Israel will be absolutely indestructible. And that's the Word of God. The hour is coming when Russia and her allies are going down after that oil and the potential wealth in the Dead Sea. How do I know? If you want to know how nations are going to line up and stack up, read it. They're called by name in the 38th chapter of Ezekiel. And that, my friend, is not supposition. That is his word, and it's infallible. Believe me. And these things are going to happen. And they're happening so quickly, so rapidly. The Word of God says, God has hooks in the jaws of the nation. Literally hooks in the jaws of the nation. And when Russia and her allies go down after a spoil, the Bible refers to it as a spoil, goes down after Israel, God himself in mercy will reach down with a gray sickle or scythe in his hand and will mow the enemies down as a scythe in the field. And Israel will be 7 months burying the dead. But my friend, this whole world is going to see a miracle. A miracle of a nation in the hands of a merciful God, a God whose word is infallible. And in that hour, a miracle will be performed such as the world has never known and will never know again. It's thrilled to it. The thrill of it all, I cannot begin to tell. And in that hour, not just a score of Jews, not just a few hundred of the seed of Abraham, but the word of God says the whole house of Israel. The whole house of Israel. The whole house of Israel. Will acknowledge the Son of the Living God as the true Messiah. It'll be one of the greatest ingatherings in the kingdom of God that the world has ever known. And the world will crown him the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. King of Kings. That is the word of God. On the other side of the coin, and remember something, there'll be suffering in the world such as the world has never known. I would like to stand before you this Saturday afternoon and tell you, whatever you want to call it, a recession, call it whatever you want to, but beloved, the future is dark. And it's getting darker. And it's getting darker. And the thing that we need most in our nation is not something that can be legislated. I don't care who our president would be. I don't care who the members of Congress might be. We put the blame on so many, we'd like to. What the world needs is something the Democrats can't give us and something Republicans can't give us. It's something that the billions and billions of dollars cannot buy. What our nation needs more than anything else in this hour is a fresh baptism of the love of God. Know that. Watch something for just a split second now. You want to know the why of these miracles? You want to know the why of it? It's not Catherine Kuhlman, it's not some personality. I'm giving you the picture, the world picture. But remember something. There is the spiritual side. And the word of God says, when ye see these things begin to come to pass, the things that I've been talking about. When you see the world situation as we're seeing it today, he's saying to his own, he's saying to the church, look up and rejoice, for your redemption draweth nigh. It's marvelous. And you want to know about these miracles? Not Catherine Kuhlman. I still contend that as surely as in the early church, they had miracle services, when every person present was healed, and they had miracle services like that. So surely before the great catching up, so surely before the church is caught up, there will be a miracle service or services when literally every person in that place will be healed by the power of God. And I believe that with every atom of my heart. And that's exactly what's happening. That's what's happening now. These great crowds come not because of Catherine Kuhlman. I wouldn't walk across the street to see her. I've news for you, she's the most ordinary person you've ever seen in your life. I want you to know that. And the only reason that I'm standing before you, it's the only reason that God is using the one that you're seeing the way that he is using her, is because I was born without talent.
I've always had an inferiority complex about my looks. Born without just fuzz on my head. I was the kind of baby that they'd say to Mrs. Kuhlman, "What a healthy child." Freckled. I bought so much Stillman freckle cream when I was a kid in Concordia that the first layer of flesh peeled off of my face. Stillman's freckle cream. I've always had a complex about my looks. I was born without talent. And one day I just looked up and said, "Wonderful Jesus, I don't have a thing. Not a thing. But if you can take nothing and use it, I offer you that nothing. I know I love you. All I can give you is my love. I'll give you every ounce of strength in my body. That's all I have to give you. To this very hour, I have never forgotten from whence I have come. There isn't a day of my life that I don't pray that same prayer and mean it with all of my heart. All I have is my love. If you can use it, take it. I die a thousand deaths. All you see is the white dress. All you see is this. Don't another person try to describe it. Don't. Then I know that's all you've seen. I die a thousand deaths before I walk out on a platform. I don't care where it is. I don't care how small or how large the auditorium or how the size of the crowd. I die a thousand deaths. I die a thousand deaths because I know better than anyone else in the whole world that I cannot give it to you, that I have no healing virtue. I have no healing power. You and I are dependent on the power of the Holy Spirit. Remember this moment, God in position, the great creator. I like to think of him as being the big boss. At his right hand in position of great high priest, the very son of the living God. And everything that you and I receive must come through Jesus. But in this place of worship is the Holy Spirit. The one through whom Jesus offered himself before he ever came to earth in the form of flesh. The Holy Ghost, the mighty third person, is here. And as he moves upon this audience, it's a moment like this that I feel like being seated because you don't need me. You may have never been in a service like this in your life before. I do not lay hands on you and pray on you. You come after you have been healed and you slip up. The steps over here are the steps over here. Eyes closed for just a minute. Every eye closed in this great place of worship today. Move upon this people. And we bow before the Father, we bow before the Son,
And we vow in the presence of the Holy Spirit to be careful to give you the glory. We vow. Move upon this people. Forget about Catherine Kuhlman. Forget about anyone else in this place today. Just close your eyes for just a moment. I rebuke that emphysema in the mighty name of Jesus. While I was speaking, somebody received the healing for emphysema. Just breathe very deeply. You'll find that you're breathing perfectly. There's not a trace of emphysema there. Just breathe very deeply as the power of the Holy Ghost has gone through that body of yours. It happened while I was speaking. There's another cancer healing someplace, and every bit of pain has left that body. It happened while I was speaking. Every bit of pain has left that body. And it's someone who's in great pain. You're becoming very conscious of the fact that the pain has left that body. In just a split second, just a moment ago, I don't know where you are in the auditorium, but somebody's ear opened. I could have stopped. I would have grieved the Holy Spirit had I stopped then. Hold that ear tightly closed. Somebody has gotten the opening for an ear. That's all that I know. Something, I don't know what it is, but something is happening in the wheelchair section. That's the only thing that I know. Something is happening back there. It's all over this place. Just softly choir, hallelujah. Softly. As the power of God goes through this body. What is this, Gene? The power of God's on her. Stop down in the foot. Stop down. Is there no pain there at all?
No.
You mean none? Walk across there. Just walk across there. Give her a great big God. Come on. Come on. Come on. Is there no pain, honey? Stomp down again. Just stomp down again as hard as you can. Where are you from?
Tucson, Arizona.
From Tucson. Dear Jesus, right now the power of the Holy Ghost has just gone through this body. We give you the praise. Tommy, let the power of God go to this. That's power. That's the power of the Holy Ghost. I don't understand it. I only know that I have nothing to do with it. Is this hers? Is this hers? Were you expecting this today?
Yes. Yes. I've seen
you. Stop down again.
I had my hand on the television.
Is this yours? Well, go on. Go on. Hook on to it and go on down.
It's your eyes.
Go on. Go on. Go on. Go on. Go on. There she goes. Go on. What is this over here? Oh, Jimmy, what is this? What is this?
Pain in her shoulder all across the neck. It's hands.
Don't cry, honey.
All the pain is gone.
It just, when you said that, it left me.
Tell the people, don't cry, honey.
Because I can't. I'm not a believer. I don't really believe I was.
She said, I'm crying because I'm not a believer.
I want to believe.
I want to believe, but she says, I'm not a believer. Beloved, we've come to the hour when it's not only faith, it's the mercy of the Lord Jesus Christ. And you did this again. Move your shoulders, good night.
Well, I can move or I can just,
is there no pain there?
There is no pain there.
Put your arms up right now. Put your arms up as high as you can. Swing your arms. Swing them. Is there no pain there?
There is.
Where are you from?
I live here in Vegas.
Right here in Vegas?
I live in Vegas.
Where do you go to church?
I'm Jewish faith. I go to Temple Church.
I knew I'd wind up in the synagogue.
The disappointment goes away. I think
CNS, thank you, William. Dear Jesus, just thanks. As the power of the Holy Ghost goes through this body, we vow to give you the praise. We vow to give you the glory, wonderful Jesus. Just do everything that you could not have done without pain. Just do it. Come here. I'm so glad for you. I'm so glad for you. This is the mercy. Look, whose wheelchair is this? Which one? Come here. Come here. Walk across there. Run. Hurry up. Come on. Come on. Look, give them a great big God. Come here, come here, come here, come here. You mean it's hard for you to believe? Go on. You tell the people what?
I don't believe it.
He said, I don't believe it.
She could hardly walk, or the pain. Her shoulder and her chest. She had open heart surgery, you know.
You mean you can't? It's hard for you to believe. Huh? Are you from? Where are you from?
Las Vegas.
Las Vegas?
We're local.
He said, we're local. Where do you go to church?
We go to Trinity whenever we
God
can.
God love you. You just haven't been able to go.
I wrote to you a couple of weeks ago and you answered.
Go on. Run across there again and show your husband. Give them a great big don't thank me. I didn't have a thing in the world to do with it. You look so funny holding your wife's hurt. Just give this dear husband a double dose. Just give it to him. Just give it to him. The power of God goes through this body. Give him a double dose.
Spine injury too.
And dear Jesus, heal his spine. Just heal his spine. Just throw it in for good measure. Bend over. Just bend over. Is there any pain there at all?
Look at that, Mama.
He said, look at that, Mama. Mama, look at it.
It's a bad heart diabetic.
Bend over again. You hold the purse now. You're more able to hold it. Go on, hold it now. Look at that, Mama. Tell the people what.
I couldn't do that before. I couldn't get down to here.
Now go all the way down. Now go all the way down. Give him a great big applause. Honey, walk down those steps. I want you to see you walk down those steps. Go on. Go on. Walk down those steps right now. Go on. Look, there she goes. What'd you think about that?
Are you sure she'll be all right?
He said, are you sure she'll be all right? Can't you see why God repented he ever made man? Sure she'll be all right. Go on, go on, go on, go on, go on. Give them a great big applause. Jean, come on. Come here. Tell what
she
happened.
She came in this wheelchair, partially blind, unable to walk, unable to move. The doctor was just questioning her. Have him come over here and talk to you.
I had multiple sclerosis.
You had what?
Multiple sclerosis.
Well, you stand there as though you're scared stiff.
Well, I am so excited.
Did you expect to be walking today?
No, I didn't expect to walk today, not like this.
Well, go on, walk across there. Go on. Pick them up high. Pick them up high. Pick them up high. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Who's with you, honey? A member of your family?
No. She came from Peru. And she's
well, where are you
there.
From?
I'm from Mountain Springs, but I'm from Las Vegas originally.
Mountain Springs? Is this her?
Yeah.
Come here, doctor.
Come
here, John Hopkins. I knew I'd need you.
You know, my doctor just ordered me another new chair. And it
your
came.
Doctor? You this, mean the doctor?
Oh,
doctor.
Not that one. I've got a chair. You push buttons and you go to town. You swirl around the house.
And your doctor has just ordered you a new one.
Yes.
Take it back and get a refund.
I guess I'll have to.
Miss Kuhlman, this is wonderful. I was talking with her a moment ago, and she tells me that since 1969, she's had multiple sclerosis. And when she came in today in the wheelchair, she was unable to walk. She had pain in her head. She had double vision and couldn't see straight. She had loss of sensation, and every bit of this has completely disappeared. She was so ecstatic when she found she could lift up her knees. I thought she was going to jump right off of the stage.
For the first time I lifted my knees.
It's really marvelous.
The first time you've lifted your knees up for years.
5 years.
5 years.
5 years.
Come on, any of your doctors, come on up here. Get busy. Come on. Come on. The first time in 5 years.
Yes, I can lift my knees like this.
Now remember something. She's using, I think that's so very often, she's using muscles.
Yes.
Ligaments that she has not used for 5 years. Go on, go on, go on down the steps. Go on, honey. She says, I sure will. Give her a week to exercise her legs. Give her a week to exercise those legs. Down she goes. And where's her wheelchair? You're taking it down. Go on, there they go, there they go. There they go. Okay, honey, here's your wheelchair. Yoo-hoo. Here's your wheelchair. Push it on down. She said, I don't want it. Well, I'll go on down. And get, that's right, there she goes. Give her a great big applause. Doctor, what is this?
This little 11-year-old boy had rheumatoid arthritis. Affecting his hips and his knees and his ankles, wrists, and this is his wheelchair.
You mean this is the little boy's wheelchair?
Yes.
Honey, is this... This is the most beautiful child. I would have come to Las Vegas just for the healing of this youngster. How old are you, honey?
11.
Tell the people how old you are.
11.
What's your name?
Doug.
I want you to see this little wheelchair. Look, this little wheelchair made for a little 11-year-old boy, rheumatoid arthritis. This is grandmother, the grandmother who brought him, remember? Walk across the stage, honey. Walk across there. If you want to see a beautiful face, if you want to see a beautiful, look at the smile on this face. Here's his wheelchair. How many feel like it's all worthwhile? Put up a hand. Look at his wheelchair. Look at the smile on this face. You can't doubt the smile. You can't doubt the smile. And Grandma brought her. Where do you live? Here in Vegas. Where do you people go to church?
First Baptist.
First Baptist Church. Pick them up real high. Walk again. Pick them up real high. Still higher. Still higher. Look, 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 look. All you have to do is to exercise him. That's all on earth that you have. Look at that face. Does nothing hurt? Doesn't it hurt?
No.
You mean it doesn't hurt? Okay, take your wheelchair. You push it, honey. Go on. There he goes. There he goes. Don't thank me. I didn't do a thing. There he goes. Give him a great big God bless.
And we vow to give you the praise. We vow to give you the glory. It's not by might, it's not by power, but it's by my spirit. Go down the aisle, honey. I wonder. Go down this main aisle. Turn around. Turn around. Push your old wheelchair, honey. This is holy ground. Oh, God, love it. I want to see you riding your bike tomorrow. Tomorrow he'll be riding his bicycle. But put the old wheelchair away and be riding his bicycle tomorrow. What is this, Gene?
Terrible pain. Pain has left her entirely.
Cancer of both hips of the bone. And that's her wheelchair. Is there no pain there at all? Dear Jesus, I worship you. As the power of the Holy Ghost has gone through this body, as the power of God has gone through this body. That's power. As the fire of the Holy Ghost. These people, for those who are new here, they are not fainting. This is the power of God. Understand it? I don't understand it. Sometimes I think these old physical bodies of ours are just not geared for this much power. This is power, believe me. Did you expect to be out of that wheelchair in this place today?
No, I said you'd be in there for a long time.
No, she said I expected to be in that wheelchair for a long time. So in that wheelchair section, you didn't expect.
No.
Oh, honey, that's all right. A wig or two doesn't make any difference. Think nothing of it. Think nothing of it. Stomp down on your legs. Just stomp down. Harder. Is there no pain? Steal harder, honey. They won't drop off harder yet. Is there no pain? Cancer of both hips. Yes, yeah, squat down. Do that. Do everything you could not have done before. Everything. And is there still no pain? None. Squat down again. Put it to the test. Then go back to your doctor and have the whole thing. Are you amazed that you're without pain?
Yes,
walk
I
across
am.
There. Go on. She said, I expected to be in that wheelchair a long time. Come here.
Wait. I can't talk about. Paralyzed, stop. Came from Denver, totally paralyzed on this side, no feeling, and her son's with her. She just got out of the hospital.
Did you fly in from Denver?
Yes.
Tell the people what.
We just flew in yesterday morning, my mother had a stroke in June of 72, and I've got to tell you something. This is a confirmation because I'm a flight attendant for United Airlines, and I graduated. I went to New York, and I called home and talked to my father, and he said that she had a complete stroke, and they didn't know whether she was going to live or die. And my first OJT flight was to Las Vegas the next day. The next day, it was to Las Vegas. And I said, oh, Lord, and it was a brand new, I wasn't even a Christian. And I just prayed that the Lord would heal her. And when we believed it, and we felt led to come, and my mother's had paralysis on her right side. She just got out of Swedish Hospital in Denver and had over $3,000 worth of medical tests run on her a week and a half ago. And the doctor said she'd be on medication the rest of her life. And she's healed.
Did you believe it? Put your arm up. Put your arm up. Swing your arm.
Oh, praise the Lord.
Swing it. Pick up your legs. Pick up your legs. Pick up your legs. You can't open your hands.
She could never squeeze me this hard before in her right hand.
Are you sure this is your mother?
No.
Did you expect all this to happen?
No. Well, I didn't know if I had.
That's power. My friend is the power of God. That's proof to the old skeptic that I didn't push her down. This is the power of God.
God in this place. Oh, honey, don't forget. Yeah, you forget about the wig. Nobody cares. A little thing like a wig, who cares? Honey, oh, look at this. This is thrilling. That's all right, honey. That's beautiful. That's beautiful. Yeah. That's all right. In a few minutes, I'll take it off and try it on myself and see how I look at it. Think nothing of it. Put both arms right straight up. Swing your arms. Can you tell any different in one than the other? None. Pick up your legs right now. Pick up your legs. Where can this be verified? What hospital?
Swedish hospital, Dr. Bloomquist.
And when you came to the, you were paralyzed on which side?
On the right side. My face was as numb as could be.
Do you feel me now?
Yes.
She also had a bladder infection.
Any doctor, what happened?
I had surgery.
Where are my doctors? Come on. This face. See if there's any paralysis of the face left there. Your doctor
close
will
your
be...
eyes tightly. Don't let me open. Now look up at the
We're having a little clinic.
Okay. Now clench your teeth. Now can you whistle? Okay, good. Now put your tongue out. All right. Fine.
All right. What do you find, doctor?
I don't find any evidence of any paralysis.
Give her a great big applause.
Oh, mother.
Go on down there. Give them a great big applause. I didn't respond.
This gentleman has had both of his ears open today.
Are you a doctor?
Who are you? You're a scientist.
I don't want you to forget who I am, because I know Concordia.
He said, I want you to forget who I am, but this is a scientist, and it's true. The two hardest people in the world to convince, a doctor and a scientist. What happened to you today? We'll forget.
You made a statement to the audience. Just now somebody heard for the first time.
Yes.
I had damage to both ears and had gone to an ear specialist and had earphones put on, and he turned the frequency up and he said, it's no use you getting a hearing aid because both nerves are dead.
Both nerves are dead.
So then your attendant down there started to giving me a test, and pretty soon I told him, I said, she's talking louder than you are.
Do you hear me perfectly now?
Oh, I hear you do.
You hear me now?
I hear you.
You hear me now?
I do.
You hear me now?
I hear you now.
Do you hear me now?
I hear you now.
Do you still hear me?
I still hear you.
And the nerves are dead in both ears, and they wouldn't even fit you with a hearing aid.
No, sir.
Did you believe when you came in here today?
No.
Did you not believe when you came in here today?
That's right.
What's right? You didn't believe.
I didn't believe anything could help me.
Why did you come?
I lost faith in everything.
Why did you come?
Well, sort of.
Out of curiosity?
Curiosity.
Do you want to know what God is really like? Do you want to know this is what God is really like? This is His mercy. Do you believe now?
I sure do.
Give him a great big God bless you. God bless you. There goes a scientist who came in and didn't believe a thing. Tell me, is this impossible for her to walk? Is this impossible?
Yeah, the doctors just took my whole knee out January 6th.
Doctor,
no
tell about this. You've been interviewing
Ms. Coleman,
her.
She had very severe pain in her knee. She had very radical surgery on her knee. She can't bend it, but she had very severe pain after the surgery, and the doctor told her it would be months before she'd ever
and
get out of the wheelchair.
Been removed?
It was the knee. They removed the entire knee.
The entire knee has
yes.
been removed.
Yes, I had a
Which knee?
My right knee. I can't bend it, but if it doesn't hurt. And I couldn't walk before. I came today without my crutches.
And this is what you were wearing?
Yes.
To be able to walk?
It attached into my shoe, and it came full length up into my hip.
Attached to your shoe and, yes, and all the way up?
I have a metal piece down in my shoe that it clicked into.
Walk across there now. Walk across there now. And you mean that was impossible? The whole kneecap has been removed. Give her a vote. Both kneecaps have been removed.
And I have an artificial one still in the left knee, but it works.
Did you expect to be walking today?
Well, I was hoping and praying I would, but I just kept praying I would.
It seemed so impossible.
Yes, and I...
Dear Jesus, from this moment on, as the power of God goes through this body, as the power of the Holy Ghost just goes through this body, we vow to give you the praise. We vow to give you the glory forever and ever. We give you the praise. Do you know how impossible it is for this woman? It's impossible for her to walk.
Oh.
Is this all new to you? You've never been in anything like this before.
I've been.
And she's scared to death.
Go on.
Keep right on. It's impossible. It's impossible for her to be walking without all this paraphernalia. Give her a great big. This is oxygen. This man has a hole in his heart. Did you ever go to a church service where they had an oxygen tent? What do you call it? It's an oxygen what? What, doctor? A what?
An oxygen tent.
An oxygen tent. He cannot live without it. He even has it while he sleeps. And the man himself can't believe it.
Not yet.
He said, not yet. Walk across there. Go on. Walk across there. Just walk across there. Go on. Go on. Come on. You won't fall apart. Go on. Keep on walking. Go on, keep on. How many have to admit this is God? Put up a hand. Come on. How do you feel?
I feel great. I feel good.
Is this hard for you to believe?
You bet.
Where are you from?
Here in Vegas.
Are you from
Indian Springs?
Indian Springs?
Yeah.
Do you go to any church?
No, not here lately. Yeah.
Not here, but you go to
Indian Springs. Indian Springs.
Where?
LDS Church.
LDS Church.
Indian Springs.
LDS.
Mormon.
Yeah. You're a Mormon.
Yeah. Well, I sure thank you. Hold back.
He says, I sure thank you. Well, honey, I didn't have a thing to do with it.
Well, yeah, I've heard you all day, but I think maybe just this thing.
Yeah, he said, I heard you all day. He seems like this is an all-day thing. You feel great, huh?
You better feel great.
What are you going to do with the whole thing? Here's his
throw it away.
Here's his oxygen tent.
Don't need it.
And here's his wheelchair. You cannot leave this service today the same person that you were before.
Yeah.
Go on down there. Walk down those steps.
Okey-doke.
He said, okay, doke, all right, go on. Walk down those steps. Down he goes, go on. Walk down those steps, go on. I don't know what to do with it all. Just sit there a moment. Forget there's anyone else here. Take anything you want for the Master. Just look up. Just look up right now. and worship him softly. Hallelujah. There comes a time when life must end, and even that physical healing that you receive comes to an end. I'm talking about the greatest miracle that a human being can know. I'm talking about that spiritual healing, that miracle that every person in this place can have. I don't care who you are. And you'll say, Catherine Kuhlman, that's what I want, that spiritual healing. I want that delivered from sin. I want the forgiveness of my sins. I don't care who you are. I don't care the sins of your life, how steeped in sin that you may be. If you come to him, he'll forgive your sins. He'll transform your life. He'll give you peace of mind and peace of soul. Jesus says, come, and the Spirit says, come. And you come and I'll pray for you. Come from all over the auditorium. Come and stand right here and I'll pray for you. I'm talking about that spiritual healing softly, very softly, slowly. There's something about that name. Here they come. Jesus. I'm talking about that spiritual healing. That's what I want, Catherine Kuhlman, that new birth experience. I want him to forgive my sins. I want that miracle that is the greatest miracle in the world. That miracle that is for all of eternity. That's what I want. Peace of mind and peace of soul. Complete security. Jesus says, come, and the Spirit says, come. Come. There's power in the name of Jesus. And still they come. Come on. Come from the balconies. Come from everywhere. He'll give you that greatest of all. And still they come. The aisles are all filled. Then stand where you're sitting. If you can't get out of the aisles, just stand. The aisles are filled everywhere. Jesus. There's something about that name, the great high priest. That one who ever liveth to make intercession for you and for me. Put up both hands, come on. Savior.
away. And still